the Financial Sense Lifetime Income Program. Here's your host, Jim Puplava.
Well, welcome everyone to this week's Lifetime Income. I'm Jim Puplava, and of course, May is graduation month. You have kids that are graduating from high school and from college. And that is going to be the subject of today's program. We're going to talk about going to college. How do you pay for it? The consequences that we see today in terms of the student debt and also the cost of an education. We will also be speaking with one of our advisors who is a recent graduate. But let me throw some figures out to you to just give you an idea of where we are today. According to a 2019 study, the average cost of a private education is $34,740. For a state education, it's $9,970. And if you're going to out-of-state, $25,620. But hold on, that is just tuition. It doesn't include room and board, books and supplies, transportation, and other expenses. When you add all of those together, brace yourself. $51,000 for a private education, a little over $25,000 for a state education, and $41,000 for a out-of-state. Currently, student loans outstanding are over $1.5 trillion. One out of four Americans have student debt. That includes almost 45 million Americans. The average student debt is $37,000 or $393 a month. Now, if you look at that $37,000 in student loans, let me tell you what the equivalent is. It would be equivalent to 20% down payment on a $185,000 house or a $10,000 down payment on a $370,000 home. Or you could buy a brand new Audi 4, a Tesla Model 3, or Ford F-250 truck. Or if you live in a sunshine state, you could pay for a wedding, a swimming pool, or the startup costs for a business. So college costs have been going up. And they've been going up faster than the rate of inflation. In fact, faster than the rate of inflation for medical, which is hard to believe. So if you take a look at where these costs have gone over the years, I can remember when I started junior college, a full semester cost was $45 for a full semester. Today, according to the College Board, the average tuition is $3,570. So since when I started college in 1972, that is, the cost of even a junior college is up 8,000%. So you can imagine if you've got two or three kids, and even if you're going to a state school, that's $25,000 a pop. That's $100,000 per kid. Multiply it times three kids, it's $300,000. I want to talk about the typical path to education, and I want to bring in one of our advisors. His name is Josh Nunn. He's recently a graduate from San Diego State, majoring in financial planning. And Josh, you know, typically millennials your age, you graduate from high school, you usually pick a state school or a private school, you go away to school, and all of a sudden you're facing either $51,000 in cost or $25,000 in cost every single year, which is a big burden to parents. That's the typical path for most students. You chose a different route. Tell us about it and why.
I've always been a proponent of saving money, not necessarily because of the financial reasons, but because of the smart reasons and the, you know, obviously the power of compounding interest. When, especially as a young student, as a young saver, you know, my parents didn't come from a very, you know, fortunate, wealthy family. So they didn't have a lot of the opportunities that a lot of average students have nowadays. You know, my mom didn't necessarily go to college. My dad went to a trade school and he went to the military for 6 years and served in the armed forces. So for me, college, I'm actually the first of my family to graduate from a four-year college institution. But my journey looked a lot different than the average college student out there. In fact, I did the 2x2 approach, which I know, Jim, it's something that you talk a lot about on the show. And for good reason, because it is an extremely important consideration. College is obviously a very huge investment. and it's a huge cost as well. That's the reality. I did the 2x2 approach, which is really at the fundamental level, just doing 2 years at a local community college, staying at home, saving money, working part-time, and then spending the last 2 years of my college career transferring to a university where I can get the diploma, I have the experience, and I also have all of the, obviously, education completed in the coursework, ready to move on to the next level.
You know, the thing that you bring up, Josh, you mentioned that you went to a junior college, and this is, listeners to this program know I'm a big proponent of the 2+2 approach. 2 years at a junior college, 2 years at a state. And Josh, the annual figures for, let's say, a 2-year local college is $3,570. But in that figure, they have $8,400 room and board. So staying at home, you save money there. The thing that I found surprising, and let me ask you if you found this, the tuition, let's round it off to $3,600, books and supplies or almost half of that. I have a son right now in graduate school, and he brought home a textbook that he paid like $150. Did you find that to be the case?
Textbooks are kind of a scam nowadays. They are so extremely expensive. And what I've noticed a lot of publishers doing for a lot of these college textbooks is they will come out with a new edition every year and mark up the price almost 100, sometimes even 200%. So the older editions that may have 98% of the same information are actually just being marked up so that they can profit. And that's not, you know, my place to say, but it is a trend, and it's obviously something that's been affecting a lot of college students, because you're absolutely correct. The cost of books, the cost of supplies, you know, has gone up, along with just the cost of tuition and room and board alone.
Yeah, because when I went to college, you know, most of the books, if it was a standard cost, you know, like English 101, you bought them used. But today, the professor issues, changes a couple words, a couple chapters, and nobody can buy a used book. You have to buy a new book. So that can be quite expensive. Now, in your situation, you also did something. I'd like you to share your experience, because for anybody listening, we hired Josh as an intern to start out in our financial planning division. Josh, explain what that did for you, along with majoring in financial planning, and how that will affect you, for example, sitting for your CFP exam.
Yeah, and maybe, Jim, it might even be helpful to take just a brief step back and kind of share a little bit about my story and how, you know, I went to college, how I made the decision to go into finance, because that's a very, you know, personal and very interesting story to me. You know, I graduated from Poway High School here in San Diego. It's actually Chris and Ryan Puplava's alma mater as well. So I graduated from Poway High School. I didn't exactly know what I wanted to do in college, so I made the decision, along with, you know, thousands of other students nationwide, to attend community college. And that ended up being an amazing environment where I could foster new ideas and take some time to consider what exactly it is I wanted to do. And I've always, since I was a kid, had some kind of desire to pursue something related to business. I always had a creative mind, and I kind of assumed leadership positions when I was playing as a younger child and even in my high school years. And then that also led me into my community college years of, you know, finding leadership positions, whether it was in student government, whether it was the president of the business club that I was for some time on campus, and even as the vice president of an honor society. So I knew that business was the route I wanted to go. I just didn't know exactly what part of business I wanted to pursue. And so that's kind of what led me down the finance route. I had a few economics professors that really intrigued and piqued my interest as far as learning about, you know, the currency markets, macro and microeconomics, and all the very intricacies of, you know, global trade and all the things that are associated with those kinds of things. And it really, really intrigued my interest. And so I started pursuing that kind of as a degree. So by the time it was my second year in community college, I was actually given the rare opportunity to become an intern at a local wealth management company. And at that time, it was Puplava Securities, if you remember. And so I was given that opportunity. I worked there at Puplava for about 6 months. And then about shortly after that, I was actually given a part-time position as a financial planning assistant. So when I was originally hired as an intern, I was working on the trading desk with Chris Puplava, our head CIO. And then I was, you know, once I was hired on 6 months later, I was then repositioned to the financial planning department, which was a total different side of the business. I was really able to kind of see what I liked and what I didn't like. And what I ultimately learned through that whole process is I really like financial planning. It was a really interesting career, and I had a great mentor that taught me a lot from day one all the way till about 3 years later. And so, you know, sitting here now, you know, working my way up first as an intern, then as an assistant, you know, I'm now a fully licensed financial advisor, and it's been a tremendous journey.
And also, you'll be sitting for your CFP exam this fall, and one of the requirements, besides passing the extensive exam, is 3 years worth of work experience. So, Josh, when you sit for that exam and you pass it, you will get your CFP designation because you will have 3 years worth of experience.
That's absolutely correct. And the beauty about my bachelor's degree, which I just obtained from San Diego State University just this month, the major that I was pursuing is a major in financial services. And the beauty about this specific program, it is actually one of the first programs in the nation that is actually registered with the CFP board. That's the Certified Financial Planning Board, which is a national program that oversees the financial planning designation. And so this is one of the first programs in the nation that is actually certified with them. So upon completion of this program, I'm actually able to sit for the exam, whereas, you know, other students or graduates who haven't taken this sort of program, they will have to go through, you know, an 8 to 12 month long course and then pass a capstone exam before they can sit for the CFP. So the program I'm in actually covers all of those requirements and allows me to sit for the exam right out of school. So I will already have, you know, 3 years of experience, and I'll be able to sit for the CFP exam this November. So I'm really excited about that.
You know, you mentioned something that even starting your internship at our firm, where you got to see two sides of the business, the financial planning advisory side, and then also the macro markets through the trading desk. And through the course of that experience, you found out which part of it that you liked. And it brings me back to my own family. You know, we had three sons, and my oldest son was valedictorian of his high school graduating class. But at age 18, he didn't know what it was he wanted to do. So that's how we started the 2+2 program, because that's what happened to me. I worked my way through college. I came from a large family like yours, Josh. My parents didn't have the money with 10 kids to send me to college, so I had to pay for it myself. So I started out at a junior college for 2 years, transferred to Arizona State at that time before getting a scholarship to graduate school. But in that process with my son, as he started working in the business, he started out just like you on the trade desk and then eventually moving over to the investment side of things. It's one thing to learn something in a textbook. Explain for our listeners how much more meaningful actually working in the field versus just reading a textbook.
Right. I think what you're really getting at is the power of internships or apprenticeships, especially in, you know, the financial services industry or any industry for that matter. Internships are huge because they really allow you to apply what you're learning in lectures and even vice versa. I've noticed that, you know, through my work experience at Financial Sense Wealth Management, the work experience that I have here and how that translates even to my coursework, you know, at San Diego State as an undergrad, it put me above a lot of the students there, especially, you know, my peers and people who were studying very similar, you know, things to what I was studying. So that's one. And then also, you know, an internship really allows you to discover what you do and you don't like. And that's important because the last thing that you want to do as a college graduate is go into the wrong industry and then spend 5 or 10 years coming to the determination that this isn't what I want to do for the rest of my life. And the second or the third thing is with an internship or an apprenticeship, you really get to network with the right people. I've made some amazing friendships and colleagues just working while going to school, and you really make some powerful relationships that can provide fruit later on in life. And then fourthly, you know, you also get the experience that employers want. One of the largest trends that we're seeing with college graduates is they're having a hard time finding jobs because, quite honestly, employers are having a hard time finding qualified workers. So all these graduates, if they have internships or jobs coming out of graduation, then they're a lot more hireable to prospective employers and business owners alike. And lastly, I mean, having an internship or an apprenticeship really makes the transition to a full-time position easier and ultimately more likely. In my example, you know, I've been an intern. I was an intern for 6 months, and that eventually turned into a job. That's the reality. A lot of employers out there who do internships, there's a high percentage of those interns that will eventually have an opportunity to work for them full time.
Before we get on to some of the mistakes, in fact, one of the biggest mistakes I see that individuals make when planning for retirement, which is to go heavily into debt to pay for their kids' education. As I mentioned, if you're looking at a state school, you're talking about $25,000 a year, out of state, $40,000, $51,000 a year at a private college. Now, imagine if you're a parent and you have two or three kids. Let's just say you're the average household and you have two kids. They're going to state school. That's $50,000. I know at one time with my three sons, we had three sons in college at the same time. So it could be quite expensive. Josh, I wonder if you might want to comment on some of the mistakes you think you've observed with your fellow peers going to school.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think it really comes down to about four. Some of the largest mistakes that I've seen college students make. Number one, not working or interning throughout college. I firmly believe that any sort of experience that you can obtain before graduation, it goes such a long way. I know for me personally, you know, I was fortunate enough to have an internship in my second year of college. So by the time I transferred and was at a four-year university, I already had about a year's worth of real work experience in the industry that I wanted to pursue. I know the average student doesn't get that kind of opportunity, but the point is, you know, any kind of work experience in a career-related industry is it goes such a long way. The second issue that I see a lot of college students make is not budgeting. And this just kind of comes back to a personal financial note. And that is that, you know, when you're young, those are the times that you really want to make those financial habits so that by the time you've graduated, by the time you have a job, you already have a strong foundation and you already have a strong platform to then begin making smart financial decisions for the future. And the third mistake that I see a lot of prospective college students make, and I'm mostly talking about either transfer students or high school graduates, is they reach for overpriced schools. And I understand that the name on the diploma matters, but I would also argue that your career path actually matters more. The fact of the matter is that many students desire to attend a prestigious school or go to a college, maybe out of state, but you know, the fact of the matter is it may not be the best decision financially. You know, so it's important for somebody who's considering going to a college, before attending that dream school, it's important to consider the true return on investment. And believe me, college is an investment, and most oftentimes it's a very large one. Payscale.com publishes an annual college return on investment report each year, which ranks the colleges with the best value. So what they look at is the difference between the 20-year median pay for a bachelor's grad and the median pay for a high school graduate. And what they do is they subtract out each university's total four-year tuition cost. So with that, they have also some of the tools to help search for some of the best value colleges by major. So for example, somebody who's always wanted to go to Stanford may find that it's not the best value school if they want to study social sciences. And along the same lines in determining your career path, I would suggest researching some of the median starting salaries for graduates pursuing that line of work. It's typically a general rule of thumb that your total student loan debt at graduation should be less than or equal to your average annual starting salary. So with an overpriced school, this is almost never the case unless you're given significant financial aid, federal grants, or even scholarships. And the last mistake that I see college students make is not going to community college first. I think one of the biggest mistakes that the broad majority of college students make is overlooking community college. I think that community college often gets a bad rap, but the fact of the matter is junior college, community college, whatever you want to call it, isn't necessarily what it used to be. There are many benefits to beginning your college career at a community college. And real quick, Jim, I just kind of want to touch on four of them. But the first one, the obvious advantage of going to a junior college is the cost. We are all pretty much aware about how much private and public universities cost, and it's astounding to me. And for a student who doesn't exactly know what they want to pursue as a career, it's a perfect place to explore professions and not spend $20,000 a year doing so. The second major advantage, I think, is the flexibility that a community college offers. You know, not being required to live on campus provides a lot of flexibility, especially if you plan on working part-time. You know, as for me, I got involved in student government. I served as the president of the business club. I was the vice president of an honor society on campus. You know, what I got out of my experience was all about what I put into it. The third reason for community college is really the academic quality. The primary reason that community college have grown so much in popularity is because by and large, they have been significantly improving their academic standards over the last 15, 20 years. However, you know, these days it's widely accepted that students learn just as much and sometimes even more, you know, as their counterparts who go straight into a four-year university. There are also dozens of studies out there that have shown that students transferring from a community college actually outperform their peers who didn't go to a community college. In fact, most recently, there is a foundation called the Jack Kent Cook Foundation, which released a study that shows that community college students actually have higher graduation rates than their university counterparts. So starting at a community college is a clean slate. So if your grades are kept tight and you show involvement around campus, the odds are that you'll have a pretty high chance of actually getting into a great university. I know for myself personally, I had a few professors that helped me get into some of the top schools here in California. For example, Cal Poly, USC, even UC Berkeley. So the last advantage that I would touch on with respect to community college, and I'll be real brief, is class size. One of the biggest differences that I experienced coming in from a community college were the class sizes. You know, going from a 30-person classroom to a 300-person classroom is quite interesting, Jim. And in my experience, the class sizes contributed a lot to the quality of being in a community college classroom. You know, for example, in a small classroom, the lectures were more interactive, they're more engaging. I was actually able to develop personal relationship with some of my professors. And there are obviously exceptions to this, but generally, this is much harder to attain in a classroom of 200 to 300 people at a large public research university. Three of my most memorable professors throughout my college experience I met through community college. So by and large, I think community college is great. However, I do think that is, you know, the fourth, one of the largest mistakes that college students make by overlooking community college in general.
And I want to come back to this as we kind of sum up here. If you're a parent right now and you've got son or daughter graduating from high school and maybe you have two or three kids and you're thinking of college, how am I going to fund that? One way to do it is the 2+2 program. Maybe your son or daughter doesn't know specifically at this point what they want to do. And as Josh brought up, looking at the pay scale of the job you hope to attain when you get out of college, that also pays off. We had a case a couple of years ago where a client's daughter, very, very smart gal, and she got accepted to some of the top private colleges here in California. And so we were looking at a tuition that would run anywhere from over $25,000 to almost $50,000 a year. What she really wanted to do is she wanted to teach grade school. So did it really make sense to, let's say, go to a private college at $50,000 a year, which would cost $200,000 for a job that would pay anywhere from $40,000 to $50,000 when she got out of school. And as we explained the economics, and she was only one of several children, so it just wasn't $200,000 for her. It could be $200,000 for her sister and her brother. And so what she ended up doing is going through the 2+2 program. And because she wanted to teach here locally anyway, she will graduate just like Josh with no debt. And Josh, if you might explain what it feels like to have graduated debt-free and you actually have a 401k and a bank account. What a difference.
You know, Jim, I'm really one of the few. And the fact of the matter is that, you know, if we look at data from 2018, 66% of college graduates from public colleges, like the one that I attended, 66% of them actually graduate with student loans. The statistic is even greater if you're coming from a private school. About 3 out of 4 college students who graduate from a private college have student loans by the time they graduate. So for somebody like me, 23 years old, who's able to graduate with zero college debt, that feels incredible.
Yeah, and just imagine, the average student loans from graduation is $37,000, as I mentioned earlier. That's equivalent to a 20% down payment on $185,000, 10% down payment on a $370,000 home, a brand new Audi, a Tesla 3, or a Ford 250. So you can see the big difference. Any parting advice as we conclude here, Josh, that you would give to any student like yourself starting out, maybe graduating from high school and looking forward to college, but maybe not sure what they want to do, or the opposite fold, maybe somebody that says, you know what, I'm going to go to law school, I'm going to go to medical school, I'm going to, you know, get an MBA and get into finance. Any parting advice?
Yeah, you know, I would primarily say that for anybody, I wouldn't say this is even just for millennials, but it's never too late. If you want to go back and pursue a degree, I really firmly believe that if that's something you want to do, it's never too late to do so. We have so many resources available to us, especially with online schools, even YouTube, trade schools. There are all kinds of things that can allow us to learn in our own free time. And the last piece of advice that I would give to any college students that are listening to the show is, it's not a race. College and life is not a race. It's all about enjoying the ride. And it's not about how fast you get there, as long as you get there, right? So I would just, you know, leave our listeners with the fact that nothing is a race and it shouldn't be. You know, it's just about enjoying the ride. It's about living life. And, you know, you have to enjoy life too. That's really important with regard to, you know, your mental health and saving for your goals, having goals, dreaming, thinking, taking vacations. All that is extremely important. So don't rush it.
All right. Well, listen, Josh, thanks for joining us on the program. And once again, if you are a parent and you do have children that are graduating from high school and you're looking at these cost, whether it's a state school, out-of-state school, or even a private college, do consider the 2+2 program, where really your kids stay at home the first couple of years. You go to a junior college at a fraction, almost a third of the cost of a 4-year state school, and even more so when you take a look at, you know, almost 10% of the cost of a private school, where you can actually save quite a bit of money by going to a junior college. And remember, when you go on to the state school, if you go that route, when you get that degree from the state school, it doesn't say a half and half degree. It says a degree from whatever state school that you graduate from. So in the meantime, we are going to be covering a few more topics on education, including tax-free education, as we explore 529 plans, and then also talk to a student aid counselor, because there's a lot of money out there that parents and students are not taking advantage of. And we want to thank you for tuning in. Until we talk again, we hope you have a pleasant week.
The Financial Sense News Hour is for informational and educational purposes only and should not be considered as a solicitation or offer to purchase or sell any securities. The investments, investment strategies, and investment philosophies discussed or presented on the News Hour each involve their own unique risk factors, which are not discussed on the show. Responses to listener inquiries are based on the personal opinions of the Financial Sense staff and do not take into account listener suitability, objectives, or risk tolerance. Financial Sense News Hour and its parent company shall not be liable for any financial losses that result from investing in any companies mentioned in Financial Sense or arising out of the use of any material on the News Hour. Please be advised that you invest at your own risk.